Okay, it's on. Well, good morning, dear students. Welcome to your video conference for multicultural context. Today, we're going to continue with the topic of sustainable development goals. So here is the screen ready. Well, as I told you before, last class, last Wednesday, we introduced the sustainable development goals. In the global aspect or in the total aspect. Today we're going to be talking about the Colombian situation, what is more particular. So this first part is to remember a decade of action that the planet has until 2030. With only 10 years left to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals, world leaders at the SDG or Sustainable Development Goals Summit in September 2019 called for a decade of action and delivery for sustainable development and pledged to mobilize financing, enhance national implementation, and strengthen institutions to achieve the goals by 2030. Leaving no one behind. So this is to remember that in the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals, everybody is included. It means families, institutions, governments, and the deadline or the year that the United Nations are going to check if the Sustainable Development Goals are complete or not is the year 2030. So this means that the planet, institutions, and families have 10 years from now to complete these goals. Also to remember, well, we have this document that was submitted last year. This report is from 2019. And since the creation in 2015, it was 5 years ago, the 2030 agenda has provided a blueprint or the instructions for shared prosperity in a sustainable world. It means a world where all people can live productive, vibrant, and peaceful lives on a healthy planet. So that is the this is the main idea of the Sustainable Development Goals, that the planet has, well, these three characteristics: productive, vibrant, and peaceful lives on the planet. I give you the address or the website in here that is from the United Nations. So if you want to check the report more completely, you can go to this website that appears here on the slide, okay? Well, some common questions that you may have or when you see the Sustainable Development Goals for the first time, maybe some questions arise. And here I reproduce some of these questions. The first is, what is sustainable development, or how people understand sustainable development either in the communities or in industry? So we can take sustainable development at home or also in big institutions. Another question is, how will the Sustainable Development Goals be implemented? Well, it has to do with the legal aspects and also the, well, the logic that it brings to the companies or institutions to implement them. You know that nowadays, many institutions, if we are talking about our universities, for example, they have to implement this type of goals. So universities are also included, and they are supposed to implement the ecological, the social aspects in this case. Another question that arises from this topic is, how will the Sustainable Development Goals be monitored? So what is the control that institutions are going to be taken? In this case, the United Nations have some representatives around the world. If you remember last class, the last presentation from Wednesday, I was telling you the countries and the particular cities where the United Nations have their offices. For example, in South America, the main office is in Santiago, in Chile. So the way that they monitor the completing of the goals is through these offices and other organisms that we're going to see later. Another question, the fourth, is how much will the implementation of this sustainable development agenda cost? So, in terms of money, is it expensive? Is it affordable for institutions or for countries to do that? Another possible question is how does climate change relate to sustainable development? Well, in the last session, we were talking about climate change. And well, there is no secret that global warming is a reality. So this topic of climate change is really crucial and is important when we are talking about the development goals, because in many of the goals, well, or some of the goals that are projected have to do with climate. So this is something really particular in this agenda. And the final question is, are the sustainable development goals legally binding? So if they are just to the legal situations of the countries, remember that they are issued by the United Nations and they try to promote the keeping of human rights or the implementation of human rights around the world. So it is supposed that the SDG or Sustainable Development Goals are going to be aligned with the legal aspects within the nations. Well, this is in paper, in theory, because you know that there are still some countries which violate human rights. Well, talking about the Colombian scenario, as I told you before, we're going to be focusing the SDGs in our local community or this country. So this is a document that I found when I was trying to search for information about SDGs in Colombia. This document was issued during the government of Santos. So it has to do with this past government, what Juan Manuel Santos did as a president to try to implement the SDGs in Colombia. The source is also here. The complete document is on this website. So when you have the slides, you will be able to go and open the document and search it. I just bring you to this class the important aspects of the SDGs in Colombia. For example, they give some indicators. Well, as I told you before, this was during the government of Juan Manuel Santos. So this document was from 2014. It means 6 years ago. The indicators that they have are population, the per capita index, the real growth rate. They have the rate of unemployment also for that year. They have also the exports and the inflows given in dollars. In that case, they give this information in dollars. And they conclude in this report that Colombia is a middle-income country facing structural challenges. So when we are talking about structural challenges, this is because we are a country in way of being developed. We are not a developed country, but we are a developing country. So in that case, the structural challenges is what the industries still have to do to promote job opportunities and, well, good structures in many ways. Also, they conclude that relatively high inequality, poverty, and unemployment. So this is no secret for us, for the Colombian situation, that these three aspects, inequality, poverty, and unemployment, are a virus or are a problem, right? So they give this information in this report. They also report on technological and infrastructure gaps. Remember that a gap is like a boundary that has maybe big limits. Nowadays, with this isolation or this quarantine, people realize that maybe in some municipalities, in small towns, people don't have access to the internet. So this happens to many people in the cities. Maybe most of you, because you live in Bogota, well, I remember that most of you in the class live in Bogota, or maybe some of you live in Chía or in Mosquera. But well, these are cities or small towns which usually have access to technology. But in this report from 2014, they confirm that technological and infrastructure situations are not the best in the country. And also, they said that Colombia is focused on ending the longest internal conflict in the hemisphere. So remember that during the presidency of Juan Manuel Santos, this government made some important changes, bringing the guerrilla to La Habana, Cuba, and they tried to implement a peace process or el proceso de paz. So it was relevant during those years, 2014 and 15, maybe, during this process of peace. So they really remark on that. Right, that was the present scenario in that year. Well, also, according to the Sustainable Development Goals, they are based on a previous stage that was the Millennium Development Goals. Hubo algo que antes de implementar los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible, los cuales ya empezamos a hablar desde la semana pasada, hubo una fase previa que se llamaba los objetivos de desarrollo del milenio. Estos objetivos de desarrollo del milenio eran más pocos, como vemos aquí eran solo 8, y se resumen allí en los Millennium Development Goals. En los objetivos sostenibles del gobierno se amplía, perdón, del milenio, yo ya a nivel global, se amplían a 17 porque cubren más áreas, ¿no? Entonces, en esta parte del documento, ellos hablan de ese proceso que tuvieron para implementar los objetivos de desarrollo del milenio ya proyectados a los objetivos de desarrollo sostenibles. The topics that you can see in the slide are 1. Reduce poverty and social exclusion. Recuerden que este tema o este objetivo de desarrollo del milenio, ahora en los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible se llama No Poverty, que es el primero de los objetivos que aparece allí en la lista, ¿no? Entonces aquí vemos ese que es Reduce Poverty and Social Exclusion. The second is Achieve Universal Primary Education, que ya dentro de los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible se llama Education Quality es uno de ellos, creo que es el cuarto de los objetivos y habla sobre Education Quality. Number three is Promote Gender Equality and Empower Women, que es el que ahora se llama Gender Equality, right? Number four is Reduce Child Mortality. Bueno, este se integró con otros y habla sobre el objetivo de salud, más adelante veremos. Pero como un objetivo del milenio, acá se refería en específico a los niños, ¿no? Reduce Child Mortality. Number 5, Improve Maternal Health, que también dentro de los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible ya habla de la buena. Ah, bueno, ese objetivo ya recordé, se llama Health and Well-being, que es salud y bienestar. Entonces vean que este par de objetivos del milenio, el número 4 y 5 que vemos aquí, se unieron en otro que se llama Health and Well-being. Number 6, Combat HIV and AIDS and Tuberculosis. Bueno, ellos veían un objetivo por aparte que era controlar lo que es el VIH, el SIDA y la tuberculosis. Eran un objetivo del milenio en específico. ¿Esto por qué? Porque en países de la África subsahariana y en otras regiones que veíamos en la clase anterior, también veíamos que el flagelo del VIH es tenaz, ¿no? Entonces, como objetivo del milenio, se planteaba uno específico, pero ya dentro de los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible, pasa también a ese tema de health and well-being. Number 7 is the ecological aspect, is ensure environmental sustainability. That now in the Sustainable Development Goals is about life on land and life underwater. Entonces, ya como objetivos de desarrollo sostenible, se amplía por lo menos a unos cuatro escenarios, ¿no? La vida en el agua, la vida en la tierra, o sea, es la superficie, y también todo lo que tenga que ver con el desarrollo sostenible en el medio ambiente. Number 8 is Partnership for Development. Este objetivo del milenio, como lo estamos viendo acá, es el que se convirtió en el número 17, en el último de los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible, que de hecho no cambia mucho.
Profe, I'm sorry, I can't see the number 8 and number 7, the
Ah,
topic.
ok. Number 7 is Ensure Environmental Sustainability. That is
I
number
cannot
7.
see on the screen.
Ah, okay. And number 8 is Partnership for Development. Partnership for Development. Number 8 is very similar to the one today because it's for Partnerships for Goals, I think is the name. So number 7 and 8 are basically the same. Well, guys, this is to remember that before the SDGs existed something that was the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals. Well, in the chat, we have some contribution from Gina. Well, I like that Gina is always very participative, so this is really nice. Gina says the discouraging thing is that some of these sustainable development goals won't be achieved as expected for 2030 because of COVID-19. Yeah. For example, quality education, increase of poverty. Yeah, this is really true, Gina. And unfortunately, with this problem of COVID, many of the goals for 10 years now on is they are going to be almost impossible to reach, or maybe they are going to be how can we say that? Maybe reformulated. Yeah, they're going to be maybe restated because some of the goals were supposed to be achieved in case of a normal life. What we can call a normal life is people producing, going to the streets, working, etc. But this aspect that Gina mentions is really important, that because of COVID, some of the goals are going to be changed. Well, in this report by the previous presidency, they also mentioned the post 2015 development agenda in the National Development Plan, that is 2014 2018. Recuerden, chicos, que en este aspecto el Plan Nacional de Desarrollo es un plan de gobierno que se dicta, pues, obviamente dentro de cada gobierno. Cada 4 años se van dando estos planes de desarrollo. Entonces, en el plan de desarrollo anterior, el que fue hasta el 2018, cumplían o incluían estos aspectos de ese Plan Nacional de Desarrollo. This is the Colombian National Development Plan. They include strategies to accomplish the post-2015 development agenda with a prospective approach with a view to 2030. So in that case, they are trying to give anticipation to what goals they can achieve by 2030. Also, another goal is to eradicate poverty in an irreversible manner in all the national territory. Again, we have the maybe we have the fallacy or we have the ideal thing that is going to be this, to eradicate poverty in an irreversible manner. While we can see that in regions like La Guajira or Chocó, there are still people who live in extreme poverty. So this is, well, something that is very nice on paper, but in reality is different. Also, attain sustainable development through adequate articulation of its economical, social, and environmental dimensions. Well, they underline the key aspects that are economic, social, and environmental dimensions because these are the dimensions that are covered in the SDGs. So that's why they mention this with emphasis. And finally, they also implement transformative measures with a territorial approach to improve collective well-being and reduce gaps among regions. Well, this has to do with reducing inequalities or maybe empowering women, as they also promote in the SDGs. Also, in creating a high interinstitutional commission, they have an objective or they have a key aspect that was shall be in charge of preparing and implementing the SDGs through public policies, plans, actions, and programs with prospective planning and the monitoring, follow-up, and evaluation of these goals with their respective targets. So this is part of the document that ex-President Santos presented 4 years ago, right, during his government. Also, they show the implementation gaps that were located at the national level. So it means in our country. What are the implementation gaps or the limitations? There is a need for transfer and development of clean technology. So here again, if we are a developing country, we still have this technological problem that is to implement clean technology. So technology that is friendly to the environment. Also the capacity building in research and development. So these two aspects that are desarrollo, investigación, or investigación y desarrollo, these are aspects that many companies are still promoting. So many companies have research and development departments, and they try to keep on mind the goals, the sustainable goals. Also, another gap is strengthening institutional capacity at the national and subnational levels. So the institutional capacity has to do with like the ways to promote the fulfilling of these goals. But you know, one big problem in our nation is still corruption. So if there is corruption, there is going to be problem to strengthen this institutional capacity, because there is always going to be a lack of money or lack of, personnel, or, I mean, if there is no money that is injected in this government, there are going to be always these gaps about the topic. A fourth gap that they mention is access to concessional financing, especially for resilient infrastructure development. And finally, the gap that they mention is financing for adaptation. So you can see the social, the technological, and also the economical aspects are still a problem or a burden for this government for implementation of the gaps. Well, also, I found on the internet something that is the PNUD, or for the abbreviation in Spanish is the PNUD, que es el Programa de las Naciones Unidas para el Desarrollo. Entonces, unido al documento que les acabo de mencionar, que salió en el gobierno de Santos hace 4 años, pues encontré esto, que es el Programa de las Naciones Unidas para el Desarrollo. Recuerden que los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible fueron implementados desde la ONU, las Naciones Unidas. Entonces, por eso esta rama, digamos, esta rama de la ONU tiene que ver tanto con la implementación de los SDGs o los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible en las Américas, o en especial en Hispanoamérica. Este programa pertenece a las Naciones Unidas, pero es una organización descentralizada que colabora con gobiernos y ciudadanos en la búsqueda de soluciones para el desarrollo humano y el desenvolvimiento de diversos proyectos. Entonces, a una de las preguntas que leíamos al principio de esta, iba a decir recital, de esta videoconferencia, al principio una de las preguntas que teníamos era, what about the monitoring? ¿Cómo se hace el monitoreo entonces de que se cumplan estos países? Pues en parte, digamos que en parte ese monitoreo se hace por medio de este programa, el Programa de Naciones Unidas para el Desarrollo, o su acrónimo PNUD. Well, this leads to this week's project, guys. This week in the Google Classroom, we're going to open an activity that has to do with this. Entonces, este insumo que tiene que ver con los proyectos que se han cumplido en Colombia, esto de fecha debe venir como de 2015, más o menos, no recuerdo la fecha en la que pues se implementaron estos proyectos de la PNUD, pero ya por lo menos en a nivel Colombia vemos que existe esta página, que está aquí también el link, es de las Naciones Unidas. Entonces les queda como insumo, ¿cuál es la idea? Que ven los proyectos a nivel Colombia que están haciendo pues dar cuenta de que los SDGs estén trabajando aquí en las regiones. Entonces ahí en esta captura de pantalla vemos, por ejemplo, estabilización y paz territorial, o capacidades locales para implementación del programa de desarrollo. Ellos cubren varios aspectos, sobre todo en lo social y lo tecnológico. Entonces, trabajo con las comunidades. Esto tiene que ver con el proyecto de esta semana, que va a ser buscar información que nos permita ver cómo se están cumpliendo esos SDG aquí en Colombia y qué obras dan pie o dan fe de ello, ¿no? Entonces, este va a ser un insumo también que pueden consultar en la página que aparece allí. Otra página que encontré también es Asociación de Fundaciones Familiares y Empresariales. Y aquí hablaban de una reunión, una comisión que ocurrió el año pasado. Si vemos la fecha ahí, es de septiembre del 2019. Y ellos trataban de definir esta pregunta o de traer resultados para esta pregunta. ¿Cómo avanzan los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en las ciudades de Colombia? Entonces, en este artículo sobre una reunión que se hizo el año pasado en la Universidad Javeriana, ustedes van a poder encontrar también entonces esos avances. Me gustó mucho porque esta información es mucho más actual. Es de hace unos pocos meses, septiembre del año pasado. Entonces, también les va a quedar como insumo para que averigüen ese ejercicio. Más adelante ya vamos a mirar en qué consiste el ejercicio que vamos a hacer esta semana dentro de nuestra clase. Bueno, acá encontré también información del tiempo. Esto fue un pantallazo que encontré. No, es parte de la tarea que van a hacer, pero es un ejemplo de lo que ustedes pueden buscar en la red de noticias para esta pregunta. Por ejemplo, ¿cómo está Colombia en cuanto a desarrollo sostenible? Ahí dice, un estudio asegura que el país tiene puntuación del 69% en el cumplimiento de los ODS. Si ustedes recuerdan, en la sesión del miércoles al final, yo les mostré un mapita que está en la página del SDG.index y allí nos mostraba, muestren a ver si aquí está el mapa. Sí, vean, acá está el mapa que hicimos el ejercicio y alguien me preguntó, teacher, ¿cómo está Corea en los objetivos? Entonces, recuerden que hay un mapa que se llama así, el SDG Index, que también quedó allí en el Google Classroom, ese vínculo, y nos permite ver esa información. Entonces, si ustedes van a ese mapa, allí encuentran, ese día yo solo les mostré el puntaje de Colombia, ¿no? Que sale así, Global Index Score 69.6. Entonces, esa es la puntuación que tiene Colombia sobre 100 en el cumplimiento de esos objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Ese día solo vimos esta información, pero cuando uno va a la parte inferior de la página, dentro de ese mapa, encuentra ya estos demographics, ¿no? Entonces, dice Colombia, Latin America and the Caribbean, SDG Global Rank. Entonces, está el ranking de Colombia dentro de los 162 países. Esto también nos lleva a una reflexión, chicos. En las Naciones Unidas, recuerden que son 193 países los que están incluidos como aliados de las Naciones Unidas. Pero vean que los SDG solo se están siguiendo en 162 países. Entonces, ¿qué estará pasando en los otros 30 o 31 países que están por fuera? ¿Por qué no, como decimos en Colombia, por qué no se le medirán a esto de los SDG? Entonces, es una reflexión, ¿no? Colombia está en el puesto 67 de 162. Ahí dan otros índices, ¿no? De lo que tiene que ver con el ingreso per cápita. Y dentro de la misma página, este mapa, que recuerden se llama el SDG slash index. Recuerden, el vínculo está en Google Classroom, entonces de forma definitiva lo pueden encontrar ahí. Ese mapa también nos trae estos estadísticas de Current Assessment of the SDG Board. Es súper importante porque cada objetivo, como ven allí, de los 17 que hay, nos está mostrando Colombia cómo está. Entonces, si ha mejorado, flechita hacia arriba. Si está igual, flechita naranja. Si ha disminuido, si han bajado, hay flechita hacia abajo. Lo que hay flechita hacia arriba en naranja o en amarillo, que está como en una forma diagonal, es que va mejorando, pero hay cosas por mejorar dentro de esos cambios, ¿no? Cuando está la flechita verde hacia arriba, como vemos por ejemplo en Climate Action y Life Below Water, es porque los esfuerzos han dado en verdad resultados esperados. Si vemos ahorita con lo del COVID, con la pandemia, obviamente si ustedes hicieran una verificación así Pues digamos, estamos hablando de una situación hipotética, que nosotros fuéramos a verificar cómo estará la vida bajo el agua ahorita, pues esto daría unos resultados buenísimos porque no está habiendo el mismo nivel de explotación en las aguas como se da normalmente, ¿no? Entonces, hay unas situaciones que obviamente van a cambiar para bien y otras no muy bien. Veamos lo que nos decía aquí Gina Alzate en el chat. Ella decía: Quality Education, que es algo que va a mejorar obviamente con esto del COVID. Entonces vean que aquí, de acuerdo con la información del año pasado, porque este mapa que les estaba mostrando es hasta la actualización de 2019, vean que Colombia en Quality Education está con una flecha hacia abajo. Es decir, ahorita con lo del COVID es mucho más lo que tiene que cambiar, ¿no? Entonces, para recordarles, ese mapa nos va a servir de gran insumo sobre cifras y datos que tienen que ver. Allí cuando ustedes entran ya cada objetivo, Quality of Education, Reducing Inequalities, van a encontrar más información. Entonces, súper recomendado este insumo para el ejercicio que vamos a hacer esta semana. What else do we have? Ah, well, guys, talking about the SDGs is sometimes a headache because it gives you like this idea of, oh, the world is not changing for good, or our planet is not going to resist. So I know the feeling because I myself, as a teacher and as a researcher, come across with these ideas that, well, living in a sustainable planet is a myth or is a legend. But the good side is that we can help from our homes. So, something that I found on the internet and especially on the United Nations website. Well, you know that the United Nations have a complete website about the SDGs. So, you find all of the topics about the implementation and the following of the programs. So, within the United Nations website, I found this, that it's the Lazy Person's Guide to Saving the World. What is this? This is a document that has some key advice or key aspects for us, for people of the street, on helping the planet. So, this was an introduction: fight inequality and injustice, fix climate change. The Sustainable Development Goals are important, but it seems impossible that an average person can make an impact. Should you just give up? Is the question. No, change starts with you. Seriously, every human on earth, even the most indifferent, laziest person among us, is part of the solution. Fortunately, there are some super easy things we can adopt in our routines that, if we all do it, will make a big change. So, this is something that, as I told you before, will help us to do at home. Well, before I tell you this, I have some contribution in the chat. Tatiana says, for that reason, the ocean in Cartagena, the newspaper reported that the ocean is more clear or is clearer for that time. Yeah, that is true, Tatiana. Also, I have a friend and she lives in Santa Marta. She's originally from Bogota, but she got tired of Bogota. She was sick and tired of this atmosphere, and she moved to Cartagena a couple of years ago. She lives in front of the sea, near Playa Salguero. Well, if you have visited Rodadero, Salguero, and these beaches in this area, you can relate. So my friend who lives in Santa Marta, she told me that the ocean is clearer and, well, basically, it's much more beautiful than other seasons because of this, because of the quarantine. The oceans reflect this positive change. So the pandemic is something horrible, but if we are talking about the planet is taking advantage of this for breathing, right? So our species are breathing. Tatiana says, yeah, the beach Taganga. Yeah, in these places like Taganga or Tayrona Park, the consequences of the pandemic are positive impact for the species and the sea. So this is something good, right? Now, guys, coming back to the things that we can do at home to help the Sustainable Development Goals to happen are these. One key or one tip of advice that they give you is save electricity by plugging appliances into a power strip and turning them off completely when not in use, including your computer. Well, basically, this is what we call in Colombia tener una extensión, ¿no? Tener un power strip es como una extensión donde conectan varios electrodomésticos y cuando no los estén usando, apagar esa extensión y así se ahorra energía. Another tip, tip number two is stop paper bank statements and pay your bills online or via mobile. This is something we are doing in the house now. You know that with the quarantine, there are no rapicades, there are no supercades, there are no rapito pagatodos or these things. So one way, one alternative is to pay online. So we have to become more technological, or we have to become greener, not printing the receipts, not printing the Claro receipt, but you can pay online. So this is another tip. Tip number three is turn off the lights. Your computer or your TV screen provides a cozy glow. So turn off the other lights if you don't need them. So in your apartment or in your house, if you really don't need a light, turn it off. Another tip, offset your remaining carbon emissions. Well, there is an app or there is a website in which you can check your carbon emissions. This is in the climate neutral now. In this way, you help reduce global emissions faster. Bueno, esto dentro de los ODS es que encontré es algo que algunos países, digamos, que están, o algunas sociedades, que están como muy al día con esto de Go Green, con ese eslogan de Go Green. Hay gente que tiene aplicaciones en sus celulares o hay compañías que le hacen tomar este test a los empleados de offset your carbon emissions. Es, cada persona puede detectar, digamos, en estos websites o aplicaciones, detectar cuántas emisiones de carbono está produciendo al año o en el semestre. En Colombia, pues de pronto no somos muy seguidores de esto, oh, check your carbon emissions, porque no tenemos aún esa cultura, pero por lo menos con estos tips desde casa sí lo podemos hacer. Well, another question. What else can you do to reduce the damages to the planet? So this is the crucial question now. Here we have more tips at the second level, that is the household hero. So they presented that you can be a hero in your home. Another tip is air dry. Let your hair and clothes dry naturally instead of running a machine. If you do wash your clothes, make sure the load is full. So it has to do with the washing machines at home, or drying the clothes in the patio or in the yard. Well, this is something that is very Colombian, so there is no problem with this. In the chat, Michael says that another tip is take a bath 2 times a week. Well, showering every other day is something that some people are doing, especially here in Bogota, because when it's very cold and you don't find the need to take a shower every day, you can switch to have showers every other day. And about this, what Michael is saying, we have the tip, that is the second. Take short showers. Bathtubs require gallons more water than a 5 or 10 minute shower. Well, if you take a bath, as Michael says, is because you have a bathtub or a jacuzzi in your house, obviously. But you know that not many families in Colombia have a bathtub or jacuzzi. So the advice is taking short showers for 5 or maximum 10 minutes. Another tip is eat less meat, poultry, this is carnes frías, and fish. More resources are used to provide meat than plants. Well, here the we can call the subliminal idea is to become a vegetarian, maybe. Not totally, because you know that it has to do with the habits, and many families have the meat habit. So it's difficult to change the family's tradition to say, okay, everybody, let's go green. But in this case, the advice is eat less meat every week, right? Another tip is freeze fresh produce and leftovers if you don't have the chance to eat them before they go bad. Well, talking in a Colombian way is recalentar la comida, right? Don't throw away the food that you didn't eat last night. You keep it in the freezer or keep it in the refrigerator, and then you make a calentado. So this is something that helps. Well, fortunately in Colombia, we do have this tradition, right? Because in some countries, they just waste the food after not touching it. But in Colombia, we are more resourceful, so there is no problem with that. What else? They also recommend this, recycling paper, plastic, glass, and aluminium, which keeps landfills from growing. Well, here the moral or the story is basically we should go into recycling in your community, in your apartment buildings. You should separate the trash. Also, they recommend buy minimally packaged goods. You know that Almacenes Éxito went into this controversy recently because Almacenes Éxito are selling bananas in a plastic bag, tomatoes in a plastic bag, or champignons into a Ziploc package. So these packaged goods are not a good idea for the planet because you can find the same vegetables and fruit with no plastic. So this is the moral of this story. Also, avoid preheating the oven. Unless you need a precise baking temperature, start heating your food right when you turn on the oven. Last weekend, on Saturday, I was cooking something in my house. I was preparing, wait, I forgot already. Okay, some red peppers, unos pimentones rellenos. So I was making my red peppers in the oven, and I didn't preheat the oven. I just put the peppers into the oven and I turn it on. Why? Because it consumes or it takes more electricity when you preheat the oven for 10 or 15 minutes before. So I don't do that. I just put the peppers into the oven and turn it on immediately. Another tip, replace all appliances with energy efficient models and light bulbs. En este respecto, recordemos el caso de Nigeria, cuando estábamos hablando de ese caso en particular de la globalización y sus efectos negativos en Nigeria. Si recuerdan, hace unas 2 semanas que hablamos de ese caso. En Nigeria, uno de los problemas que tienen con la contaminación es por esto, porque ellos no reciclan, o sea, no compran estos electrodomésticos que son modelos eficientes o green, como los llaman, energy efficient models, sino que toman viejos computadores, viejas baterías, viejos TVs y no hacen ese proceso, ¿no? No los reciclan por algo más nuevo, sino que los siguen utilizando. Entonces, el consejo allí es replace old by new. Eso incluye, por ejemplo, los bombillos ahorradores. Ahí dice light bulbs. Entonces, los bombillos ahorradores también nos van a ayudar a ese respecto. And finally, the last tip is use cardboard matches. They don't require any petroleum, unlike plastic gas fill lighters. Entonces, la recomendación es utilizar cerillos o fósforos de cartón. Acá, por ejemplo, no sé si en mi cámara, es que de hecho no sé si están viendo mi cámara. Acá tengo una caja de cerillos de fósforos que están hechos de cartón, ¿no? Hay incluso unos como de Madeflex, de imitación madera, que también pues ayudarían en parte a no utilizar los briquettes, ¿no? Los lighters, gas fill lighters. Ustedes saben que en la producción de los briquettes o encendedores de plástico, pues toma mucho mano. Entonces, lo que recomiendan es estos cerillos de cartón, ¿no? O de elementos reciclados. Tatiana says, now there are different products which packaging are in carton, like milk. Yeah, this industry, the milk industry, is going back to the basics. I heard that Colombia, some companies of milk are trying to go back to milk that is bottled, or basically glass bottles, o botellas de vidrio. So what Tatiana says is really like that. Or corn flour, says Tatiana. Yeah, so these products that go ecological are also a good decision for you. Here, well, this is a website that I found on the internet. Ahí está el link abajo también. Cuando vean la presentación pueden ver el website completico y hacen un top 10. Ellos dicen the top 10 of eco-friendly materials. So they have, for example, that, okay, glass bottles or crystal bottles. They have organic cotton for the clothes. They also have wood. Bueno, aquí en este era un caso de una madera africana que se llamaba el ticker. Bueno, era un nombre específico de un tipo de madera africana que es muy bueno y que es eco-friendly, ¿no? Entonces recuerden que esos eco-friendly products son los que ayudan al medio ambiente. Entonces, ahí en esa página de Wanda Thompson también aparecían rubber tires, los neumáticos de caucho, ¿no? Rubber tires. Ustedes han visto que acá en Colombia hay gente que hace muebles, sillas, mesas con estos neumáticos viejos. Now, they also, en este manual que estábamos hablando de the laziest friend, the laziest person advice o como los consejos para la gente perezosa, entonces también dicen que uno puede ayudar fuera de casa. Bueno, en un escenario real, si no estuviéramos en la pandemia, pues hay cosas que podríamos hacer afuera, pero bueno, esperamos que en poco tiempo se puedan hacer. Dice aquí, shop local, supporting neighborhood businesses. Keeps people employed. So basically, this is don't go shopping to Éxito, don't go shopping to big supermarkets, but go to the small shops. So this is something that in the quarantine I have done. And I need, if I need some vegetables, I go to the small shop in my neighborhood. So this is a way to help. Also, another tip is shop smart. You can plan meals, use shopping lists. And avoid impulse buys. Evitar la compra impulsiva, ¿no? Compradores compulsivos. Don't succumb to marketing tricks that lead you to buy more food than you need, particularly for perishable items. This is maybe because on Merkeo or Rappi or all of these applications for buying food, maybe they give you, okay, you take, I don't know, 10 tamales for 20,000 pesos, or take 2 kilos of oranges for 2,000 pesos. And then you buy a lot of food, and then the food is going to be wasted because you don't consume all that food. So the recommendation is avoid buying food that you are not going to need. Also, another tip is buy funny fruit, frutica rara. Ahí cuando se refiere a funny fruit, es la fruta que ya está en un estado más o menos rarito, pero que no esté totalmente mala, ¿no? Entonces dice, buy funny fruit. Many fruits and vegetables are thrown out because of their size, shape, or color, because they are not right. Entonces, esa fruta que ya está con un color raro o una forma rara, ay, que es que este coco salió ovalado o esta piña tiene dos cabezas, etcétera. Entonces, esa fruta rarita también se puede comprar e incluso la venden más barata. Dicen, buying this perfectly good funny fruit at the farmer's market or elsewhere utilizes food that might otherwise go to waste. Well, in Colombia, many people don't have problem with this, and many people have to eat this. So this is not much of a problem if you are accustomed to shopping. Gina says, but I think there are no changes without radical actions. Yeah, so obviously the big changes come with little actions from people in their homes, for example. Also, they recommend shop only for sustainable seafood. There are now apps like this one that will tell you what is safe to consume. Entonces, aquí encontré esta aplicación que se llama The Seafood Watch. Es una aplicación del Monterey Bay Aquarium. Entonces, como les decía, lo que es la cultura norteamericana, los canadienses o algunos europeos tienen aplicaciones para eso. Entonces, que para consumir cosas eco-friendly o que dónde están las tiendas verdes en mi ciudad. Entonces, ellos están como muy al día con eso de Green Revolution, ¿no? La revolución verde. Entonces, recomiendas qué tiendas son ecológicas, qué restaurantes son pro-friendly. Entonces, cosas así, ¿no? For transportation, bike, walk or take public transport. Save the car trips for when you've got a big group. Well, during the pandemic, this is impossible because basically people can only bike or walk with limited time. Also, use a refillable water bottle and coffee cup. Cut down on waste and maybe even save money at the coffee shop. Well, this was when you were at the university. When you were at the exi, you went to the cafeteria and maybe you bought your coffee in a cup, in a plastic cup. But now you are in your house, so obviously we recycle this material because we are drinking from porcelain or from China cups, so it's easy to do it at home. Another tip that is very important when you go shopping, bring your own bag when you shop. So whenever you go for shopping or groceries, you bring your own bag. Pass on the plastic bag and start carrying your own reusable totes. So basically, you need this ARA or this Justo y bueno bags that are the bags for shopping. Another tip is take fewer napkins. When you don't need a handful of napkins to eat your takeout, just take what you need. Again, if you are eating in your house, if you make a hamburger or if you are eating pizza in your house, you don't need those many napkins. You can take just one or two napkins for cleaning your hands and your mouth. Well, they have many more tips. Shop vintage, so you can buy secondhand things, so you can buy secondhand shops, basically, or segundas. Maintain your car. For maintaining your car is basically that it consumes clean energies or don't burns out or doesn't burn out a lot of gas or CO2. Donate what you don't use. You can give donations to local charities. Clothing or televisions or things that you don't use, don't throw them away, but promote donations. Vaccinate yourself and your kids. Well, vaccinations are in fashion because of the COVID, but also be careful on what vaccines you are taking. No, they should be biologically legal or, well, like this. Take advantage of your right to elect the leaders in your country and local community. So it also has to do with the people that you support in politics to go green. In the fourth level, that is the last level, if you have fruit or snack that you don't want, don't throw it out. Give it to someone who needs and is asking for help. So if you see people in the street asking for food, you can give them that food. You can mentor young people. It's a thoughtful, inspiring, and powerful way to guide someone towards a better future. And finally, women earn 10 to 30% less than men for the same work. So pay inequality persists everywhere. Voice your support for equal pay for equal work. So this has to do with the institutions, how to change the institutions. Well, they give many more tips for you to go green or keep informed. And basically is that. Finally, I want to show you some climate action. So these are people who are saving the planet from climate change. So we have some ambassadors or famous people. Here, for example, we have actor Leonardo DiCaprio. He is a messenger of peace from the United Nations. Jack Johnson, who is an American singer and actor, he is an ambassador in North America for the goodwill. Chinese actress Li Bingbing, she's a UNEP Goodwill Ambassador. Recuerden los UNEP, que eran el plan de desarrollo local, entonces ella es una embajadora. Also, Ian Somerhalder, he is an actor. Si recuerdan las crónicas de vampiros, él también es un embajador de Goodwill de las Naciones Unidas. Y está Ellie Goulding, the singer. She is a UNEP Goodwill Ambassador. Entonces vean que las celebridades también se unen al cambio y apoyan allí. Sobre la noticia, chicos, esto lo encontré también en una de las páginas de las Naciones Unidas, United Nations. Entonces ellos están hablando con este tema del COVID, obviamente están pues informando, ¿no? Entonces, Rights and Dignity. Ahí en la tercera dice, Journalists provide antidote to COVID misinformation. Entonces, que los mismos periodistas tratan de dar información sobre la mala información que alguna gente está promoviendo con este tema. COVID can't stop music on International Jazz Day. Entonces, celebraciones musicales que tienen que ver, pues, en medio de la pandemia. Aparece allí Greta, la famosa Greta Thunberg, que el año pasado se hizo pues tan popular. Dice, Greta launches campaign to support UNICEF protection efforts against COVID. And that's it. Por último, les quería mostrar aquí un recurso que les voy a colocar allí en su plataforma de Classroom para que se animen. Entonces, es una ruletica, se llama el SDG Game. Uno escoge un objetivo en la ruleta, por ejemplo, Gender Equality. Y allí hacen unas preguntas. Entonces, only one country in the world had more women than men in parliament in 2017. Which country is it? I would say Rwanda, for example. Ah, miren, ahí salen. Question two. Which country was the first in the world to give women full political rights? The right to vote and the right to be elected. ¿Cuál será? Finland, I think. Question three, how many countries in the world had a woman as president or head of state in 2017? Uy, si no nos dan ayudas. How many countries a woman president? I would say five. Question five. Who should do the cooking and cleaning in the house? Males, females, or everyone should help out? Bueno, si hablamos de gender equality, diríamos everyone should help out in the house. And question five. What percentage of researchers in science and technology are women? I would say 30%. And here, show answers. Show your answers. Yes. Your score is 4 out of 5. Bueno, acá vemos entonces, yes, correct. Ah, en esta pregunta, how many countries in the world had a woman as president or head of state? Era 20. Entonces, chicos, esta ruletica, que está muy interesante, se llama así, la ruleta de los Sustainable Development Goals, para que practiquen y estén repasando entonces como los ítems de cada uno de los goals, ¿no? De los objetivos. Les iba a mostrar aquí, en el grupo de Multicultural Context, ya sé que vamos acabando, ya nos queda poco. En este momento se acaba de abrir aquí en el trabajo de clase, se abrió una actividad, chicos, que es la que vamos a estar trabajando esta semana. Entonces vamos aquí a tercer corte. Aquí está, The Sustainable Development Discussion and Research. Entonces, aquí están las instrucciones del trabajo que vamos a hacer. Hay un PDF con unos logros y como unos targets o indicadores de logros, si los podemos llamar así, de estos objetivos al 2030. Entonces, para una de las preguntas, que es la pregunta 5, dice, Check the Goals 2030 document and explain if you think the targets for this goal will be achieved. Entonces, lo que vamos a hacer en este trabajo es escoger uno de los logros, ¿sí? Uno de los 17 logros. Cada uno escoge un logro y sobre ese logro, entonces, es dar el nombre, qué ámbitos en Colombia se ven afectados por ese logro o por ese objetivo, ¿cierto? Y el resto de preguntas tienen que ver, entonces, en torno a ese objetivo que escojan. El insumo, como les digo, el PDF que ven acá es para la pregunta número 5, que es revisar ese PDF y cada logro trae como unos objetivos de logro, ¿cierto? Si lo llamamos así, son los 4 objetivos que tiene más o menos cada logro y la idea es que entonces discutamos eso allí. Este trabajo es el que vamos a hacer a lo largo de la semana y la entrega quedará hasta el otro fin de semana. Entonces, pues ahí tenemos para que hagan ese trabajo a lo largo de la semana. ¿Listo? That's all for today. Thank you for turning out, guys, and see you next class. El miércoles no vamos a tener sesión, ya que vamos a asignar este trabajo. Entonces, a cambio, van a tener tiempo para que vayan trabajando allí.